The opinions and views expressed in the following presentation do not necessarily reflect those of GameCon Radio or its affiliates.
Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your world. Welcome to Moebanshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameConRadio.com. We rock your game. Tonight, one of my very favorite people, Joe Resnick, is coming on, and going to be talking about Bigfoot. There is a feedback from Joe's phone, but there's not a lot we can do about it. Joe, you're not listening to the radio show on a speaker, are you?
No, I am not. No. No, right. I'm listening. First, I'd like to say hi to everybody. No, I just have a regular old phone handset, and I'm at a location in the mountains.
Yeah, not to worry. We're trying to get a hold of Professor Ron Stewart, but he hasn't answered his phone yet. We'll be trying again in a few minutes. I want to advise everybody and warn everybody, in the Northeast we have our first summer heat wave coming, and by Thursday it's going to be in the 90s. It's going to be really bad, guys. So I'm hoping that everybody takes care of their elderly, make sure your animals have water, and watch children, because when it gets really hot like that, kids are going to look for a way to get cool, and when you've got your back turned, they're going to find, you know, pools that are unattended. They're going to find different kinds of things to try to cool off, and that's when really bad things can happen. I also want to remind you, when the electric goes out and you have somebody who's having a problem with the heat, fill the tub up with cool water, let them sit in it. But again, you got to be careful with children and elderly. Make sure that you don't leave them alone and the water unattended, because children will go into the bathroom and they will go in the water to play with it, fall in, and then you've got a horrible situation. Animals need shelter. They need water. They need food. Please make sure, if you see animals that are struggling, if you see animals not being taken care of, please report them. I don't understand how anybody can turn a blind eye to animal abuse, because if somebody will abuse an animal, they'll abuse a human. So please roll over on these people. Again, watch children around water. When it's very hot, it's very dangerous around children. There's a lot of news about bath salts again, and I just want to make sure everybody is on the same page. These are not the things you put. When they talk about bath salts in the news, they're not talking about the stuff we sprinkle in there to make, you know, our skin feel better. These are chemicals like crack. They're homemade chemicals, that kind of thing. They're manufactured, and people think, well, I'm going to get high off of them, and they just call them bath salts because they kind of look like bath salts that you use in the bathroom. There are a lot of people that are going off the rockers. Now, a New York woman a couple of days ago attacked a 3-year-old child, tried to bite the kid, and this is because their body heats up horribly. They start stripping down, and they become extremely thirsty, and they think, well, there's blood there, I'll drink that. Obviously, they're hallucinating, they're off the rocker, but this stuff makes them Superman. And they're very dangerous, and tasers don't even take these people down. So please, if you know anybody dabbling with that, call the cops. I mean, you do not want these idiots coming after you, you know? I wish I could say that, you know, there are no zombies, but this is as close to a zombie as I can possibly think of. They are mindless creatures that attack other human beings. That's a zombie. Speaking of zombies, Comic-Con International is right around the corner in San Diego this year, and one of my favorite magazines, Monsters of Filmland, will be there. But they asked the guy who created The Walking Dead for AMC, Robert Kirkman, to design a special car for it. So Hyundai, the Elantra Coupe, has been changed, and they're going to have one made up to look like a zombie killing machine that he designed just for this comic convention. It looks really cool. If you you know, Google Hyundai, I guess Hyundai, the Hyundai zombie survival machine, you get a look at it. It's pretty cool. Obviously, it's just a mock-up. You know, I don't know that they're even considering making a line like this. But I thought it was really cool. And he says, I did it because I always like to try to make myself do something I've never done before just to see if I can pull it off. So, you know, The Walking Dead is going to be back on in July with the next season. And a lot of the characters we've come to love in the TV show are going to be gone. But it's a really cool show. So kudos to them coming back for another season. And kudos to Kirkman for designing a zombie killing machine. Very cool. And with that, I would like to introduce our guests, Dr. Joe Resnick, who is a wonderful person. He's a inventor, he's a scientist, he's a philanthropist, he's just a really nice guy. And welcome back to the Lair, Joe.
Thanks, Mo. It's a pleasure to be back, and I'd like to say hi to everyone out there. Say hi to all the troops overseas, and hope everyone's well, come home soon. And I was hoping Ron Stewart would be able to join us tonight. Perhaps he can jump in later. And when we go to break, Mo, I'll be changing telephones, and I apologize to the audience that the clarity up here in the mountaintop isn't all that good. They just ran new lines up here a couple of days ago.
Yeah, so. you're up in the Kentucky Mountains, Green Mountains.
Well, I'm in Green Mountain. It's actually North Carolina. It's okay. It's between Hickory and Asheville, North Carolina. It's up in the mountains. Beautiful place. Very, very, very beautiful. Very picturesque. Very rural. Good place. And you know, the fact of the matter is, there have been a couple of Bigfoot sightings up in this area, and I've called a couple of my friends in. I have two guys coming in this weekend from Florida. You know, there's a controversy about quote-unquote hunting Bigfoot now, and there have been several arrests where folks in the National Forest who have attempted to organize hunting parties, as it were, even with cameras, have been arrested and fined for not having a permit to investigate a special species permit, it's called. So yeah, you've got to be real careful even about going into the national parks and taking pictures, and the last thing you want to do is tell anybody that you're hunting Bigfoot, because you need a license now in the national parks and most of the state forests. They're relatively easy to get, but you have to disclose, you know, what you're going to be doing, and you know you're not going to be carrying firearms, and there's just a bunch of. But anyhow, I've got a couple of buddies coming up into one of these regions up here, and we're going to be in. They're going to be investigating some of these reports and talking to locals, and you know, we're near the Pisgah National Forest. We're only about 40 miles from the Pisgah National Forest, where reports of this nature are quite common. And all along the Appalachian Trail, as a matter of fact, just in the last 45 days, there have been over 60 reports. Some of them have surfaced, some of them have not. But you have to have a pretty keen ear and a pretty keen eye. And I have both of those, and I have some people on the inside who provide information to me. And there's a lot of activity, and there's a lot of questions about, you know, unknown species and this phenomenon we call Bigfoot. Of course, down in the lower states, even a little further south than I am, we've got the skunk ape, and we've got a bunch of different other nomenclature they place on these hominids. But it's real interesting, Mo. It's pretty interesting, and I've always personally felt that, you know, the possibility of the existence of this type of creature is not outside the realm of possibility, mm-hmm. particularly in view of the fact that I have many colleagues who are, I know the men to be absolutely sound, profound, excellent scientists who would not, you know, brazenly place their names and credibility and years of their work on such a subject were they not sufficiently convinced of the empirical evidence as well as the anecdotal evidence that, in fact, that what has transpired and been reported was factual. So, with that said, hello, everybody. I don't know if you're... Are we going to be taking calls tonight?
Yes, we are. After the first break, I'm going to open up the phone line, and I'll be announcing it just before the break. But our callers have to understand that we need to call, and we don't have a way to put people on a hold. So you'll be hearing the show immediately, and you just got to wait, and I'll talk to you as soon as I can. So don't go, hello, hello, because you'll be on. It's just that we need you to wait. Let me ask you something, because as you were talking, I was thinking, back in the day, most of these reports were in the Northwest. And now we're seeing a lot more reports down in more favorable weather areas where it's a lot warmer. I mean, we're used to hearing them in Minnesota, Washington State, Oregon, up that way. Do you think that there's a migration going on?
Grover Kranz, who passed away, Grover was a real sweet guy. He was out in... at the university, one of the universities out west in Washington State, and he spent about 30 years tracking the migratory path of the species, and he was firmly convinced that there are migratory patterns within the species, and he also qualified and attempted to quantify a real number with regard to the species and the propagation of the species and the spreading of the species and how that related to travel and particularly travel along places like the Appalachian Trail, as I mentioned earlier. There's migration going along the Appalachian. I, for one, would not go on the Appalachian Trail, simply because no. Now I'll tell you a story years ago. Well, before I tell you that story, let me speak to what I know to be factual in terms of these occurrences. Actually, it's reported as early as 1760, not only in the southern states, but in the northern states, such as Maine, up around that way, Connecticut, of the existence and encounter with what the Indians called the wild man. And they were large, large animals. And just in this area here, in a place called Boone, North Carolina, there's a plaque, and it's reported that, and everybody's heard this name, Daniel Boone, actually had an encounter and killed one of these beasts, and the Indians carried it away. Now there's a plaque, and I was at the plaque not 3 days ago up here in Boone, North Carolina, where there's a report that, you know, the famous woodsman Daniel Boone actually had an encounter. And there are also reports that Teddy Roosevelt, of course, the Rough Riders, and, you know, who's responsible for the establishment of our national parks out west, had an encounter. He and his team and his crew, that included the at that time the person who was doing the mapping. And this was, you know, after Lewis and Clark and all that stuff. Who was doing the mapping? They actually had an encounter with what was described as a family of. That, of course, they weren't called Bigfoot that time. They were called wild men, but the Indians called them Pacapa and Sasquatch and had different names for them. But that's also in the annals of Teddy Roosevelt. So, you know, there's something out there, Mo. It's undeniable that there's something going on out there. And just in the region that I'm in now, and I pass through a lot of these rural regions in my travels throughout the United States, I can see where it's absolutely possible for an unknown species to live amongst us and live virtually undetected in these massive forests that surround us. You know, we only use the roads, you know, and occasionally these animals will use the roads as well. But by and large, and I consider myself an avid sportsman, and I certainly spend as much time afield as I can, but, you know, I never really travel more than maybe a half a mile or maybe 2 miles from the beaten path.
Right.
And I would argue that most people have never been more than a mile or two from, you know, a public road.
From their car, you know, from safety.
Yeah, absolutely. For no other reason, for safety. I mean, look what's happening out west. People are running trails in the San Joaquin Valley and the L.A. Basin out there, and they're being attacked by mountain lions and that sort of thing. So, you know, a lot of people are afraid. And that doesn't even include what's happening up in Oregon State, up in Washington State. And there's a whole, I mean, if you look at that map of the encounters, and you can Google that and just mm-hmm. Google in encounters, Bigfoot, Northwest Territories, you can see where that ridge line runs the whole way from, I want to say, Mount Stewart and Mount Wilson up that way in the national park, and runs the whole way down the tip of the Sierra Mountains down to the Sierra Madre. So, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on there, and this has been going on for 200 years, Mom. I mean, this isn't just something that's happened in the last 6 weeks. I mean, this has been going on for 200 years.
Let me ask you something, okay, because, you know, this is not my expertise, but I'm just looking at it from once the Founding Fathers, you know, we got the trade all set up, you know, it's well known Benjamin Franklin was over in England. England had their zoos and all. Is it not possible they bought gorillas over that were released for some reason? And that's not perhaps what we're seeing, the descendants from that? I mean, you know...
From gorillas?
Or, yes, well, what's some kind of gorilla.
I don't know. I guess that's a possibility. You mean like a variant species of that type of hominid? I guess that's a possibility, but if that's the case, then that particular species has yet to be identified. So, you know, but that's, you know, what you're pointing out here. Yeah, that's a distinct possibility. No one knows. For example, in New Zealand, I have family in New Zealand. My nephew and his fiance live in Auckland, New Zealand. And I was surprised to learn that in New Zealand, every year, almost every month, they are discovering in the forest there and in the rainforest, there's actually a rainforest in New Zealand, that they're discovering thousands and thousands of new species of animals every month, and that thousands of other species are dying out, and this is happening every month. And you know, if it's happening in New Zealand, I would argue it's happening all over the globe, where you have new species, that are evolving, because everything is constantly evolving. So, you know, it's not outside the realm of possibility that there's some type of unknown hominid. You know, for example, Lucy was just qualified and quantified by the Leakeys, you know, maybe 80 years ago, 90 years ago. And so, you know, the possibility of the existence of this type of hominid that has, you know, that's a bipedal pentadactyl creature that walks on 2 feet and has 5 fingers and 5 toes and stuff, it's possible that type of creature exists. And, you know, it wouldn't surprise me, Benjamin Franklin, and I've read about him extensively, and he's one of my heroes, by the way. He was like the consummate entrepreneur in those days, and he sold buckskin caps and coffee makers, and he invented the coffee machine, and just a real, real go-getter. In fact, I'm a recipient of 2 Ben Franklin Partnership Awards in Pennsylvania, by the way, and funded 2 of my inventions and developed them at Pitt. But anyhow, it wouldn't surprise me a bit if those guys had found, you know, someone like the ship captain on on Mighty Joe Young or one of those old movies where they actually bought some kind of animal that no one really knew. Maybe, you know, what was it, the snow ape or the mountain gorilla was just discovered, you know, what, 14 years ago, 18 years
right.
ago. Yeah. And, you know, so...
Let me ask, what, because, and you're right, Vietnam is finding species they thought were dead for decades, and suddenly they're coming back, but all war-torn countries, these, you know, not only humans get killed, the animals get killed, the fauna is destroyed, Agent Orange, you know, so now, now that there's some relative peace, that they're starting to see these and going, oh my God, it's a new creature. No, it's not. It's just something that was taken to the brink of extinction, and now it's back.
Yeah, it's coming back, sure.
So, and so, you know, there's that possibility, but what is the difference that makes everyone think that Bigfoot Sasquatch is not an ape as we understand one?
Simply because of the, well, one of the chief reasons, not simply, nothing simple about this subject, the walk on this animal is distinct. It differs from that of the both New World apes and Old World apes, and it differs from that of men. And the way that the animal walks is completely different from, it's unique. So just the way the animal moves. And it doesn't move like an ape, and it doesn't move like, you know, an Old World ape or a New World ape. You know, has no prehensile tail. It doesn't, for as much as we know, although some videos have been released showing, I don't know, probably some of the listeners have seen the video on YouTube where it's thought that a Bigfoot is passing a small Bigfoot into a tree, and the small Bigfoot is clinging like a monkey to the tree. I've seen that one, and it was brought to my attention. And in fact, Professor Stewart and I used the Aura process to evaluate that film, and we didn't find it to be valid. But those are the kind of things that we look at. But, you know, it's really hard to say. What convinces me, Mo, of the existence and the possible existence of this type of creature is the gait and the walk, and chiefly the work done by Grover Kranz and more recently some other investigators with regard to the foot of this animal, the weight, the tracking mechanism of this animal, the gait of the animal, the distance of the gait. So also I'm one of these guys. I'm a head man. I like to look at the head and evaluate the what I call what's called a mid-sagittal crest. This animal has a particular style of a mid-sagittal crest that indicates formation of a prefrontal lobe. And if you know anything about anthropology, if you look at the progression of mankind, the hominids, the hominoids, and all these other things, the skull grows, and there is variation and differentiation in the different types of skulls, from Pithecanthropus erectus to Gigantopithecus to Homo sapiens, Homo erectus. There are differences in the skull, and that's chiefly in the area of what's called the mid-sagittal terrain.
Right.
In this particular case with Bigfoot, when Bigfoot sightings are real, and of course, if you look at the Patterson case, the presence and existence of the mid-sagittal crest is absolutely evident, and it's unique as we're able to see that sagittal crest. It comes from the Latin word sagitta, meaning bow. So we're able to see that from various angles by virtue of the film. And but that alone convinces me in the way that the head sits on the body and pivots on the atlas, that's some kind of creature. That's not a man. And I'm convinced that footage is genuine. I'm convinced of
that. And that would be the one where he kind of lifts like his hand and kind of like pushed it away, like he dismissed them. He saw them and he dismissed
exactly.
them. Yeah, well, which shows an incredible intelligence.
Well, in the Patterson film, that was a female. It was a female.
Uh-huh.
And you're right. It noticed them and just kept walking. But the gait has been analyzed by men that I know, guys that I've worked with, not only in the motion picture industry, but in various military configurations. These guys have analyzed this thing and says, look, that's not a man. That's not a guy in a monkey suit. That's some kind of animal. And whatever it is, and most of these folks that I work with, they'll never come right out and say, yeah, that's a Bigfoot. Well, they can't. They can't because of the nature of their work and the agencies and situations that they're in. They can't come out and say that, they'll lose their jobs. So, and I don't know what the big deal's all about. Hey, either it is or it isn't. And if it is, then it is. If it isn't, then it isn't. You know, I see what the big deal's all about. But I wanted to talk about this encounter tonight. I don't know how close we are to break.
We're like 3 minutes to the break, which I probably can take the break and then come back. I did pick some music that I thought would be cool for tonight. Creedence Clearwater Revival, Looking Out My Back Door. It's about him coming back from a gig and seeing some strange things out his back door. And then Jim Stafford is one of my all-time favorites, and his Swamp Witch and the Last Chant. Yeah. So I thought they would be great songs for tonight. And we're going to see if we can get a hold of Ron Stewart again. And when we come back, I'll be giving a call-in number, so everybody, you know, has to give us time to answer the phone, okay? And with that, we're going to be right back. We're talking about Bigfoot. Tonight, we're going to be taking this a lot of directions. Where do people think he came from? And some people actually believe he's some kind of genetic creature that was brought here and introduced from another planet, and there's a lot of things, but the one thing is we've never gotten a body, right? They've never recovered a body.
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay, so when we come back, we're going to be talking about that. We're going to go to break right now.
Just a reminder, guys, all our talk show hosts here at GameCon Radio volunteer their time, but you can always show your appreciation. Click on the tip jar and give them a little love. I'm sure maybe your predictions will come out a little bit better. And that's how we roll here at GameCon Radio. We rock your game and your paranormal.
This is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to GameCon Radio. Why? Because it rocks!
Welcome back to Moebanshee's Lair, Visionary Talk Radio on GameCon Radio. We're going to try to re-add Joe Resnick back in. He's going to use a different phone, see if he can cut down that feedback. He's up in North Carolina in the Green Mountain Lab, which we're very honored that Joe is taking this time to talk with us tonight. So we're going to see if we can get him on the phone right now. Okay, so he's going to try, and so you might hear ringing and all that stuff. We're talking about Bigfoot, And I don't know, I'm kind of devil advocate about this thing. I know that there's...
This is Joe Resnick. I'm unable to answer your call at the present time.
We've got him on this.
If you'll leave your name, tell me...
I'm kind of devil's advocate on this. Nobody's found a body. I understand that with all the amount of gorillas, monkeys, all kind of things that come into our country, I understand that these kind of things get loose, and all through history, our forefathers brought in creatures, you know, animals for zoos and for study and for private zoos and everything else. I understand that, but to classify or think that there's something unique out there that is kind of like a missing link is I don't know, it's just a little hard for me to get my head around. I have a couple of my own theories that I think it could be, but we're going to try Joe again and see if we can get him on. I'm sure he's trying to call Ron Stewart, who is there, and we're going to be announcing the call number in a few minutes, too, but I don't want to do that until we have Joe back on.
Joe Resnick.
Hi, welcome back.
Hi.
We're right
here.
Matt. We're right.
Okay.
Okay, much better. No weird noises.
No feedback, no.
Right, very cool. No. We're going to announce the call number now, and you've got to give us time to pick it up. And Joe, I'll probably have to interrupt you, whatever you're talking about, so please excuse me. Yes, it's rude, but I have no way of just putting people on hold, you know, because...
Not a problem, Mo.
Yeah,
not a problem.
And I are in the same control thing. The Skype number you guys want to call in is 732-707-7709. It's 732-707-7709. And if you want to call in and ask questions about what anything about Bigfoot, the crypto behind it, what do you think? Do you have a question on an idea, a theory, anything? Give us a buzz and we'll try to bring it in. So let me ask another stupid question while I have you in a hold here. Do you remember that old show, Quantum Leap?
Yes.
Yeah.
I do.
There was one that was pretty cool because the kid looks out his bedroom window and there's Bigfoot and the kid starts screaming. And it turns out that it's a guy in a ghillie suit. And what it is a bunch of Vietnam vets that are... they're all emotionally scarred and they're afraid to live with people, so they're hiding out in the woods, and what he does is put the ghillie suit on so nobody sees who he is, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
My thing has always been like hypotrichosis, you know, excessive hair. Do you think our government wouldn't possibly try to make places like areas out in desolate areas on lived in areas for people like this to live in, where they don't have to feel like they're oddities, you know? Maybe that would account for some of this.
I guess that's a possibility, but I got to be honest with you. I've never heard of anything like that, and this is the first time I've ever heard that type of theory put forth.
Well, that's not a theory. It's just a ball being thrown out into the middle of the field.
Yeah, it's quite a ball. I don't think, at least the guys that I work with in the agencies I've been affiliated with for 35 years in the government, I'll be honest with you, the least of their concern is Bigfoot.
Mm-hmm.
The least of people that I've worked with, you know, everybody... that I work with, they say, oh, it's poppycock, and even the traditional scientists, for anyone, any scientist that, you know, values his job and his research grants, for them to ever accept and acknowledge the existence of one of these xenophobes or whatever you want to call them, hominids, hominoids, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
You would have to drag the body, literally stinking, dead carcass in front of them and put it in their nose, and then they would probably say, yeah, okay, it looks like, and you know, it looks like a duck and a squacking.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, that's how adamant the professional scientific community is in many cases when it comes to this particular subject. You know, I don't, some of your listeners may have had the opportunity to watch the Animal Planet over the past month, where they've run serious stories about mermaids and mermen. They're mermen and mermaids. And I don't know if they've had the chance, or your listeners have had the chance, but that's real science. And I know two of the people on there. I know those people. I've known two of them for over 20 years. NOAA scientists. And one is a NASA scientist and one is a NOAA scientist who used to work with one of the kids that I mentored and who is going to be part of the first Mars mission. I know those people, and they are the real deal. So when they get on there and say, we lost our job because we reported this in certain agencies did XYZ, I believe them. I believe them. I mean, I'm not affiliated with those projects or those programs, but I'm aware of where they did the research and the research vessels, the ships, the names, and all that other stuff. I know because I had people there. We have people who do things, and
mm-hmm.
I know that that really, really happened. So with all that said, and of course it's, you know, it's fallen outside the context of the Bigfoot discussion, but you know, those are cryptobiotics, biotes as well. Those are unknown species.
May I jump in?
Yeah, jump in.
We had Dr. Carl Feint, F-I-E-N-T-D-T, and he's very huge in this underwater. UFOs, and it's not a large leap to think that at some point something that we considered to be a mermaid or merman was something coming up from one of those vessels in some kind of aquatic swim gear, you know, or something, you know. So I'm not, if you're going to go that far, that there are possibly submerged, you know, aircraft from other places there, then that really isn't that far to think that they're going to come up individually, I guess. I don't know.
Well, since you broached that issue with regard to UFOs, let me broach this. I feel it's not outside the realm of possibility for one of the early hominids to have evolved in an aquatic environment and actually developed gills like a fish.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not outside the realm of possibility that a humanoid creature evolved and, in fact, may be alive and living in these seas. Most of the sea is unexplored.
Right.
It's unexplored. We don't know what's in the sea. They're finding new stuff every day. It's only recently, in the past 6 months, that the Marianas Trench has been breached.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's 7 miles deep. Man has never been there. That's, you know, that's as deep as Mare Tricanus on Mars. And, you know, we can see to the bottom of that, but, you know, we've never really seen the bottom of the Marianas Trench.
And unless you are a very, very rich person who's just really nosy and wants to go down there and has the money to burn, the government needs a really, really good reason to spend that kind of money.
Sure.
Just like finding the Titanic, Ballard, that was a little bit of gravy. His real job was to test equipment for the Navy.
Yeah, sonar, exactly.
Yeah,
sonar guns.
So that was kind of like, okay, we'll let you look for it, but this is what you're really doing. Otherwise, he would have never had the money to do it either.
Well, there would be a real value in terms of not only logistics, but from the military perspective, to have a type of species similar to and smarter than the bottlenose dolphin to undertake military objectives. So, probably one of the things, you know, and I'm reaching here because I don't know this to be a fact, but if I were a betting man, if I could get one of these unknown species and buddy up with it and get it to put bombs on the bottom of boats, right, then I would do it.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah, no, that's what, if the government sees that it could be really something worth they're expending that kind of money for, they would not hesitate to use it as a weapon.
Probably not. Well, a defensive weapon. Let's qualify that.
I don't personally see our government as being a government that just likes to go out and kill just for the hell of it. Excuse my French. We've always been the good guys. The Americans have always worn their heart on their sleeves. But I do think that if something presents itself that could possibly give you the edge, you're going to take it. You're going to go for it, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I had occasion last night to revisit Philip Corso's treatise and video on Hulu about the day after Roswell. It's just really, really interesting stuff, because when I look back and at the time I was growing up and there were still tubes in radios, and all of a sudden transistors appeared and everything changed.
Yeah.
Everything changed. Mm-hmm. And according to the book The Day After Roswell, you know, you had the existence of light fiber optics, you had transistors, you had, you know, telephoto lenses, and just all kinds of new technology that surfaced. And according to Corso, all of this stuff was thrown at him, and he was in charge of, you know, giving it to companies like IBM and these major companies. I know at Westinghouse, we worked on stuff that is just now, you know, coming out. And that's 30 years ago when I was a kid. I was working on these projects that were, you know, were projects back then that were stuff that you read about in UFO magazine, or what's the old magazine that they used to have back then when we were kids, that they had Fortune magazine and those types of things were
mechanical science.
But it's, you know, at that time it was futuristic, but you know, it's reality today. But hey, I wanted to talk. We tried to get a hold of Ron, and I tried to get a hold of John Lear. As I mentioned earlier, Mo, I was on with John Wells and John Lear a couple of weeks ago talking about moon mining. Let's not go there. But John, during our conversation, mentioned that the Bigfoot was an extraterrestrial, and it had connections to lunar bases. Now,
right.
Yeah, I had invited John to join us this evening, and maybe he'll call in. I don't know. I hope he does. John's a good guy, and I have a lot of respect for him, not only as a, you know, fellow scientist, but as an aviator and as a serious scientific investigator.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people, you know, think he's. I think that he's the real deal, and I have respect for him. But I'm curious as to, you know, where he's getting his information, because he'll come right out and tell you that he's protected. He's protected, and he can just about do or say anything he wants to, and nobody's going to bother him. So
yeah, there's a fine line. You know, people look at me, and of course you're a scientist. I don't help people with hauntings from a scientific, where I'm trying to gather evidence so I can be on TV and say, look at the pictures of the ghost I got. Look, this is ectoplasma. See,
yeah. You
can all. I'm not in that. I'm strictly in it. So people stop being so afraid to turn lights out at night. So people stop scaring their children to death. You know, I'm in it to bring peace into the home. You can't raise children in that kind of thing. But, you know, people look at me and they'll sit there and they'll roll their eyes. And pretty soon I can tell that they're just listening to me. It's almost as if they've stopped processing it, and maybe some people they listen to him and they kind of have just stopped processing it. Do you know what I'm saying? I'm not sure. Do you understand at all what I'm saying?
Yes, I do.
He's protected because people, they just say, oh, you know, don't worry about him. He's just talking, you know?
Yeah, don't listen to him. He's just some kind of nutbag or something. I understand, you know, that people are classified. You know, they did the same thing to Descartes, and they did the same thing to Galileo. So, you know, I would say that if that's the case with John Lear, then he's in pretty good company.
And
myself as well. I've been compared to, you know, certain people, and because of some of the work that I've done and projects I've been involved with, you know, some of them are pretty fantastic and pretty hard to believe, but nevertheless, as real as this desk that I'm sitting at. And you know, I'd like to tell you a little story about a personal encounter I had years ago with a Bigfoot.
Yes.
And this is still in line with, and I do want to get back to this story about Ron Stewart and how his encounter with Bigfoot back in 1995. But a few years ago, my brothers and I owned a bunch of property up in the Allegheny National Forest around Tittiute, Forest County, Jefferson County, and this is forest up there. That's near the Pennsylvania Little Grand Canyon, and this is wilderness. I'm talking, this is absolute wilderness. The kinds of places that you go into, for example, the Great Buzzard Swamp up there near Clarington, Pennsylvania. You go into the Great Buzzard Swamp and you break a leg, you're probably going to die. And you get stuck in one of these places, or get stuck in a ravine, or you get snowed in, or you get turned around in the elm trees without a compass, you're probably going to die. And it's that kind of place. Well, I want to say it's 1986, my brothers and I, and there are six of us, and there were eight of us in the hunting party, my brothers and our cousins, two of our cousins, and we're in a hunting party, and we're all carrying high-powered rifles, and one of my older brothers, Paul, and his nickname's Putzy. Putzy hunts with a .458 Winchester, okay, Magnum. Okay, .458, that's Brontosaurus class. I mean, you can take down a Brontosaurus with one shot. Okay, that's about 4 millimeters short of a .50 caliber. Okay, there's six of us guys walking into the woods about 4 o'clock in the morning up in a place called the Lolita Flat. Lolita Flat is about 12 miles southwest of Marionville, Pennsylvania. Great Francis Marion, who was the famous Revolutionary War hero. Anyhow, south of Marionville, we're up in this place called the Lolita Flat. About 4 o'clock in the morning, there's six of us guys walking into this forest. We walked about 2 miles, and we had left our camp at 4 o'clock in the morning. We wanted to be posted up by daybreak. At that time, daybreak was at 6:17 a.m., so we needed about 2 hours to walk into our hunting posts. So as we're walking into the forest, we walked maybe about a mile before we all stopped. Everybody stopped, lit up their cigarettes, and we're standing there talking. And then it happened. When I say it happened, it happened. We started hearing noises, grunts and growls at first. And then we heard noises that sounded like a baby crying and a lion roaring. And we heard knocking, the knocking of trees, tree knocking. And this was at 4:30, quarter to 5 in the morning. And we were literally, I would say we were literally, the nearest home had to be 6 miles in any direction from us. And this is forest. I mean, we went in Humvees and track vehicles and left the track vehicles to walk down these logging roads that were impassable with the vehicles. But it started to happen. And six of us grown men, my oldest brother, James Marshall, was in charge of the hunting party. He ordered every man, load your gun, everybody stand back to back. So we did that. And here we are, you know, we're in our 30s and 40s at the time. We're grown men, and we've got enough firepower there to stop at least a regiment. We've got enough firepower. And this thing, whatever it was mad and loud and close. And I'm telling you this story now, and I wish you could see me. I should probably put the video camera on so you could see the hair standing up on my arms and my neck. I mean, it's literally standing up. Because I still, it still frightens me. We didn't see what it was, but we stood back to back until about, it was just about daybreak. Mm-hmm. And my brother said, come on, we're getting out of here. This area belongs to something.
Right.
And we're getting out of here. So we went. And it was shortly thereafter that I divested myself of all my holdings up in the Allegheny National Forest. I gave one of the parcels away to one of my brothers, and I sold the other camps, and I haven't been back in the woods since, and I own 50 caliber machine guns, but I'm not going back in that forest.
Yeah, so. It appears that while they might be whatever this is, and like I said, I'm kind of on the fence here, because no one's ever come up with a carcass, which is odd, because, you know, if they are animals,
it's not that odd. Listen, I've been hunting since I was a little boy, and you know, I have yet to find a bear carcass, or even a deer carcass, or a dog carcass in the forest. Here's the way it works.
Yes, something eats it.
Yeah, when something dies in the forest, it's eaten right away. I looked at a 6-ton elephant that dies in the Serengeti. In 3 days, it's gone. In 3 days, the bones it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not surprising to me that we've never found the carcass of one of these hominoids or humanoids or even ETs. It doesn't surprise me, because once something falls, it gets eaten. That's just the way, you know, primary, secondary, tertiary producers. Let's jump over here. We got a second. Let's talk about Ron Stewart and what happened to him. I hope Ron calls in. We've been trying to call him.
I put the number up in the chat. Let me say it out loud again, just in case he's listening. 732-707-7709.
Okay. Yeah, Ron, if you're out there, call in, because I want to talk about the story he shared with me. A couple of our partners some time ago. In late summer of 2005, Ron lives in out in Texas, Gonzales, Texas. He used to be a city manager and all that stuff. And quite a guy, quite good, great scientist, inventor, lecturer, holds about 15 different degrees of education. And Ron's the real deal, real cerebral guy. Well, in the summer of 2005, Ron was on his way from Wharton over to visit some kinfolk. And he always carries a camera with him. And I posted these links to the story about Ron that I'm discussing right now. And he happened to have his camera with him, and he got some pictures, some pretty interesting pictures of what he says and thought was a Bigfoot. So he took about 15 pictures of this animal.
We have a caller. We're going to...
I'm
going to have to let you call back, okay?
You are listening to Game Con Radio.
Bishop Long and the American Institute of Metaphysics is proud to announce their class on demonology. Students will receive a very detailed class on demonology, and the class will be presented by Bishop James Long, who is the exorcist and presiding archbishop for the United States Old Catholic Church. Enroll today. Visit www.instituteofmetaphysics.com or call 1-877-623-3241.
Welcome back to Moebanshee's Lair. We had a little bit of a sound glitch there, and if the caller try to call back in now, we'll try to take you as soon as we get it in. And Joe, you were telling us about the other story, the Bigfoot story, so...
Oh, yeah, about Ron
right.
Stewart. Well, Ron was on his way from Gonzales to Wharton in the late summer of 2005, And he's the kind of guy, he always carries cameras with him. When we go into D.C., he's got to leave his cameras at the door and stuff when we get into the soldier groups. So, anyhow, he always has a camera. Well, this night he's coming back, and it's perfectly clear, and he had an encounter with a UFO. So he takes 15 pictures of the UFO, and I think I mentioned this earlier. Ron and I work on some special projects that use a special analytical video and photographic analytical process that's proprietary. We do that for certain configurations and whatever. Anyhow, Ron used the what we call the ORI, Advanced Regional Imaging process, to analyze these photographs of what, you know, what appeared to be a UFO, flying saucer, so to speak. And it looked like the conventional, you know, tester-type flying saucer that everyone talks about that emanates from Area 51. Anyhow, using the process, the ORI in my process in investigating and analyzing the videos, we're able to literally go inside the craft and look inside the craft. What Ron discovered in using the process, which is based on Einstein rings and Amici Bertrand technology, we're able to go inside and look inside the craft. And what appears to be inside the craft is a hominid creature with the appearance of a Bigfoot. So, it's pretty wild stuff. I mean, I posted on my Facebook tonight links to the story about that.
That was Ron Stewart's, because I found pictures that are on a site that he took that, you know, you could see something there. Some of them, you know, I mean, if you play with one enough, you're going to make it look like whatever you want. And I don't actually know what the original one that he had looked like. Yeah. So we're kind of like at the mercy of whoever's site it is, because they kind of play with everything, you know?
Yeah, but, you know, normally I would agree with you, but I know that Ron took these pictures. That's why I'm saying these are first-generation photographs that he was working from. I would be suspect, as you would be, if they were photographs from someone else and they were third or fourth generation. But
well, I'm not suspect of him. I'm just saying the site that I saw them on.
Oh, they, yeah. Well, I agree with you wholeheartedly. I know exactly what you're saying. I agree with you wholeheartedly.
Mm-hmm.
The people at that site, yeah, I agree with you.
People, even on my site, people used to post a lot of pictures from the houses, you know, where we have the cams, and they would just keep playing with them and keep playing with them and keep playing with them, and eventually I would say, you have to understand, if you play with it enough, you're going to get it to look like something you want it to look like.
Yeah, exactly.
In
psychology, there's a term for that, you know.
Pareidolia, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
We're all looking for the two eyes and the nose and the mouth.
Yeah. We're all looking for Jesus Christ in the McDonald's pancake, you know? And it's not there.
So it's a I kind of feel bad for anybody who's had an experience, because if they do give out any kind of pictures or anything, pretty soon it gets tumbled like it's in a washer, and pretty soon it's just so ruined that nobody knows what's real anymore, and the real essence of the experience is completely lost. And then, of course, nobody believes it. I just feel bad, you know, because Teddy and I had our own. But, again, this is a problem that I have. We were driving by Lakehurst Experimental in New Jersey, which you know what it is. It's
Jersey Devil.
Yes, but it's an... Okay, we have a caller. Welcome, caller.
The Jersey Devil.
Can you hear us, caller? I think they hung up. Caller?
Yeah, must have hung up.
They hung up, I think. That's okay. You can try calling back again. But we were driving. We had seen Patsy Cline down at a roadhouse. Not Patsy Cline. What's her name? Oh, I can't think of her. Another great old country singer. And so we had been coming back, and... We Lakehurst was over to the right, and it's a naval base, but that's where they do the experimental craft go in there. It's famous for the Hindenburg crash. So yeah, we see this like ball of fire coming out of the sky, and it just stops dead above the tree line, and then it just shoots and goes along the tree line right out of, you know, sight. And Teddy and I are real quiet, and I says, did you see that? And he says, yes, I did. And, you know, my brain is saying, it's got to be something they're experimenting, even though we've never seen anything like that, that would come down, because I'm talking about probably 1979, you know, but that's when they were testing the stealth. So I kind of was like, maybe something like that. But when you tell people, they just roll their eyes. So, you know, I don't even bother trying to, you know, I know there's stuff going on. You know, I just don't understand exactly, if it is our government, why they're, maybe I do understand, if they're, the only thing that makes sense to me, we have a caller. We're going to try to bring this caller in again.
Okay.
Hello, caller?
Yes?
Hi, you're on the air with Joe Resnick.
Yes, I'd like to speak with Dr. Joe, please.
Yeah.
Good evening. How are you?
I'm wonderful, honey. How are you?
Good.
This is your sister.
Good to hear your voice.
Hey, you too, baby.
Okay, are you behaving down there in the swamps there in Virginia?
I can't tell you if I'm behaving or not.
Any Bigfoot down that way?
Good woman, you are.
I just want to let you know that I have seen UFOs, and I believe... and I believe in the blue man.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know who the blue man is.
I do. I haven't disclosed that. I'll let Mo know about this, and the listeners as well. Over the course of my career, I have had a number of different encounters, which I have not reported to the general public. However, I have put together a compendium of short stories that I call The Blue Man and Other True Stories by Contemporary Scientist Dr. Joseph A. Resnick. One of these days I'm going to publish those stories, and there's some pretty fantastic stuff in these stories. And I go through the book. There are actually about 17 different stories that range from telling about the encounter that I discussed earlier with my brothers and what we thought was a Bigfoot creature up in the Allegheny National Forest, ranging all the way to stuff that I've seen in places in Los Alamos underground, in places at Nellis Air Force Base. Because I still am active in certain areas and projects, I'm not at liberty to disclose those now, but one of these days, Mo, who knows, maybe it'll be next week or next month or in 10, I don't know when.
And maybe it'll be on my show.
Well,
next month or next year or whenever you're going to do it.
Well, you know, one of these days before I walk off this planet, there are certain things that I feel that should be known to the general public. And these are things that I've seen, and because I've sworn secrecy in certain areas, I'm not at liberty to disclose these things at this time.
And we respect that.
Yeah, but one of these days, you know, as I'm drawing my last breaths, as Jesse Marcel did, and as Philip Corso did, and men who have come before me, they've come out with the truth and said, look, this is really what happened. This is really what I saw. And by that time, you know, the way that these black operations work is, by the time they find out anything, the people that really could influence anything or do anything, they're either dead or walked off the planet. So it really doesn't matter anymore.
And I'm assuming this blue man is all part of what you're not allowed to talk about.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
That's okay.
But it has ramifications to, you know, what John Lear talks about, and what, you know, things that, and UFOs and and Nellis Air Force Base and Los Alamos and the underground caverns under New Mexico. You know, it's all, you know, a lot of the stuff I can't explain. There are things that happened to me in my life that defy convention and explanation. It's just like Travis Walton says. Travis Walton said, hey, this is just something that happened to me. I didn't ask for it to happen.
Right.
You know, I'm wrong place at the wrong time, and this happened, but, you know, it happened. And that's, mm-hmm. you know, it is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
So same thing with me, you know, my sister calling in with the blue man. She happens to know because she was there. And mm-hmm. she was there, and she was part of, you know, when I was missing for a few days. And, you know, she was part of all that.
Okay.
So there are people that know about that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, that'll be in the future. Thanks for calling in, sis.
Yeah, I think she hung up, actually. So let me ask you this. For me, when people say the government is going to outer space, they're doing, they're mining Mars since the 60s and all of that. And when I think of our space program, see, I kind of think that if we're going to go out into space, piecing together a space lab, piece by piece by piece, cannot possibly be economically a viable way to do it. They would have to build something big enough that would leave our atmosphere with a complement on it, you know what I mean, and sustain that life to go to Mars without having to stop at a pit stop here. Does anybody need, you know, McDonald's? We're going to stop at the moon for 10 minutes, you know. I mean, we're not talking a bus trip here, guys. We're talking about going into outer space and exploring it, possibly going to Mars. The only thing that makes sense for me is our governments are trying to build something that will do exactly that with a large complement of people.
You know, it doesn't take a whole lot of people to do something very, very special.
Well,
you'd be surprised what you can do with two or three guys that have the power of multidimensionality.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't think our government's trying to build something like that?
I have no idea what some factions in the government are doing. I don't have a need to know, so I really don't know.
Mm.
And I don't need to know, so.
Because
I only need to know what I work on.
That's
the way I keep it. That's the way I keep my nose clean and keep the paychecks coming.
When I see UFOs, though, I think to myself, I'm going to say 99.9 sightings are something our own governments are working on.
You're probably right. You're probably right. A few years ago, my wife and I and my youngest daughter and a couple of friends went out to Las Vegas to see the Jimmy Buffett concert. Jimmy invited me out to come to the show, so we went out to the show. We were going to go up to Area 51, the bunch of us, some of, you know, Jimmy and a couple of his guys, and I took my Humvee out there, and had her all set, ready to go up to, go out into Area 51 and go down to where the black mailbox is and go down into Groom Lake. Well, on the way out there, we had an encounter. My wife and I and my daughter had an encounter. And my daughter videotaped it. I was driving the car. So, you know, there were three of us, and, you know, none of us drink or do any of that drugs or none of that kind of crap. But we actually have a video of this red ball, and we were on the Groom Lake Road. We turned left off the ET Highway and started down the Groom Lake Road, and this red ball, and I have it posted on my Facebook wall. If you go into my videos and look at my Facebook, there it is, and you got to watch. If there are kids watching this, the language, there's some language on there from my daughter that's a little bit strong, but that's real. I mean, that is real video. I mean, that's real time stuff, and that's something that happened to us. And I tell you what, that was no airplane. It was a red ball, and when it came down, I mean, you can literally see in the video the whole area lighting up red, and then guess what? It just blinked out. It just blinked out. I got out of the car and looked. Nothing. And it was the darndest thing. So, hey, I can't explain that. You know, stuff like that has happened to Art Bell. It's happened to, you know, Jimmy Carter. It happened to Napoleon. Napoleon coming, you know, it happened to Napoleon.
Mm-hmm.
And Frederick the Great reports seeing things like this. So, you know, we can't all be crazy.
Right.
You know, there's something going on here, and you know, it defies explanation. Whether it's the government doing it, undoubtedly, you know, our military has, you know, advanced propulsion systems, and I mean, just go and Google David Adair and watch what David. I've known David since I was a little kid. I was one of the brain trusts that they took down to Los Alamos when I was 15. So, and I've known these guys. I just reconnected with an old friend here 2 weeks ago that I hadn't seen since I was at Los Alamos when I was a kid. But it was like old home week. So, you know, this stuff is real. And hey, God bless them. Every project I've ever been affiliated with, it has been to protect the United States, and I'm proud to be part of that.
That's right.
And I'm glad that we've got people out there doing that. And right. As far as the ET question and the UFO question, listen, there are stranger things in heaven and earth, Horatio. When you say the Apostles' Creed and you say, hey, I believe in all things seen and unseen, hey, there you go.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there it is. There are things that exist.
Okay. UFOs have been seen since the dawn of time, evidently, but there's famous ones, Nuremberg, Germany, in 1561. It was reported that there was a battle between metal containers up in the sky and stuff. So, you know,
in India as well.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this isn't new stuff at all. I know that somebody's trying to ask a question. Spooky was trying to ask a question, but I have yet to find it yet on the in the chat. So if somebody's going to, you know, ask a question, you have to ask. We've got another caller. Okay.
Go right ahead. Yep. Let's take the call.
Caller?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, caller.
Yeah. Dr.
Who is
Jeff.
It? Could you...
Hey. How's it going, man?
Okay.
Good evening.
Hey, I wanted to ask you if you could elaborate on any possible work with David Adair.
Well, other than what's on... Okay. Well, my work with David was... incremental. I observed some of the work that he was doing. I was actually learning from him. And the reason he was brought in was because the government recovered a type of engine that is actually biomorphic. And not only was the engine biomorphic, but the craft itself was biomorphic. In other words, when you touched the craft became part of the being. You became part of the craft, not in the literal sense where you were absorbed into the craft, but your neuropathways controlled and became part of the command and operational systems of that particular craft. Maybe it was a craft, maybe it wasn't a craft, because the way David describes it is it felt like skin. So, and his belief was, and I don't want to, you know, step out of line and quote him. You can watch his videos on Hulu or YouTube. Just go and type it in. Listen, he's a real interesting guy, and he's the real deal, too. And he was involved in a lot of tech transfers, and that's what he did for his, after he got out of the Navy. I mean, he's a real sharp guy, and he's not, there's no BS there. I mean, it is what it is. But that is the limit of my work was... maybe a day with the kid, because we were both pretty young at the time, and when he did what he did, they asked him to shoot a rocket down range from one location to another, and at that time, this imagine a 17, 18-year-old kid is, you know, light years beyond Wernher von Braun at the time. So that's the kind of mentality we're talking about here. So naturally, he came to the attention of the powers that be, much the same way I did, because I was, you know, experimenting with putting animals up on kites and sending them up in with a transponder. And that came to the attention of certain people who appeared at my door and started asking me questions about, you know, where are you getting these ideas to do this kind of thing? Much the same way with David Adair. But he's the real deal and genuine guy. Just go and search him out. Thanks for calling in, caller.
Thank you for calling in, caller. We have... You mean Peter was banging on your door in the social services?
No.
What's Rocky the Squirrel?
Well, back in those days, they didn't have social services. Back in those days, you know, we lived in, you know, still have my house there in rural Pennsylvania. They didn't have social services back there. You were the social services, you know.
Hey, you've been watching too much of Rocky.
It was guys in suits, and not the men in black either. You guys in suits. And you know who used to do all the dirty work back then? The state police.
Right.
Yeah, the state police used to, they'd be the one come knocking on your door with some guy in a suit.
Well, they had outfits designed after the Nazis, didn't they? We have another question in the chat.
All right.
From a few minutes ago. So why can't the public know things about what's happened or is happening? Is it fear of the reaction the public might have or something else we don't normally think of?
Well, the general consensus in groups that I'm affiliated with is that the majority, first of all, the government treats the majority of the population like you're an 8-year-old or a 9-year-old. And many of the people who run government agencies, they don't have a whole lot of respect for the common man. And the general consensus, and it starts the whole way at the Vatican. It starts at the Vatican and just trickles down through the governments and through the different agencies, through the Bilderbergs and through all of these conspiracy things that you hear. And they're all real, by the way. Mm-hmm. Regardless of what you might think, they're all real. It's true. That stuff, the majority of the stuff that you hear is true. Remember this: if a fact is a fact will remain and it'll come down through history. If it's fallacy, you'll never hear it. But if it's factual, or even if there's one iota of truth to it, that's called a truism. That truism will obtain and come down through history. That's why you keep hearing stories about the Masons, the Masonic Lodge, and the Bilderbergs, and, you know, the Great Owls and all this stuff, because it's all true. It's all true. There are people out there who are elitists and control the world, and those people believe, and it probably reaches back to the Vatican. It did with Pope Leo, and did, you know, when they tried to quell and quench and quiet Copernicus, for example. Look what they did to him. Put him in jail. Said, you know, we're excommunicating you. So, you know, they don't want the people to know because, first of all, it would upset economies on a global scale. Imagine if a UFO sat down on the concourse there in D.C. What do you think would happen in this country? Well, people would, there would be anarchy, the likes of which you can't even imagine. I'm talking medieval. I mean, you know, animals and dogs and stuff like, you know, like Dan Aykroyd says, if dogs and people and animals, it would be that way.
Right.
So, naturally, you know, it's if the UFOs and all these different things would come into the public acknowledgement, and there's a big push, you know, the guys who are doing the Project Disclosure, the Disclosure Project, and there's a bunch of them, and those guys are real scientists, too. They're not hoax, and I know some of them are very wealthy men, and so they're not in it for the money either. And
right.
They're not selling books either. I mean, these guys are the real deal and have stepped away from their occupations and their, you know, their life's work to really, you know, put forth a message. But, you know, to answer that question, it's probably, you know, probably what everyone believes is that the common man probably couldn't handle it. I mean, just think what would happen if the fact that extraterrestrials exist was acknowledged by some formal body of government or by some formal church. That would mean that maybe there's no God, and maybe there was no Jesus, or maybe no Buddha, or maybe no Allah, or, you know.
You would have social breakdown is what you basically
absolutely
would have.
On a scale, Mo, that we can't even comprehend it, the scale
right.
of the upset would be so great. So maybe in the greater context of things, you know, it's better just to let people think what they want to think and believe what they want to believe, and let the conspiracy theorists be out there. And maybe there is some disinformation going on. Maybe, you know.
Well,
maybe.
The good thing about this kind of thing is nobody's getting together and saying, "Wait a minute, You know, we want to, you know, they're not all getting the truth because they're all going at it from different things. There's chaos. And in this instance where you have this kind of information, and I get into arguments with people on my site all the time who are into conspiracies, and they say, well, we should know. And I am a red, white, and blue Yankee Doodle Irish girl. And I'm very grateful for everything that this country has done for my people. We were just a bunch of potato farmers, man. But I don't want everybody in the world knowing what's going on in my government. I don't want Russia to know. I don't want China to know. I want my government to be sound and be able to act without reporting on CNN, okay, we've decided we're going to do this, because that's when everybody comes out of the woodwork and says, no, you can't do that, don't do that. And it's just not good for any country or any group to divulge every ounce of information. And I take it back. I drop it all the way back to being a parent. When you're talking to your children, your eight-year-old child, you don't say, and mom and da went into the bedroom last night and we got out a little bit of the KY jelly. No, you don't. You say, you go and you say, well, mom and dad love each other so much that you're going to have a baby brother or sister soon.
Yeah.
Okay? Yeah. And that's enough. Now, when they're 24 and able to handle more, and you sit there and say, yeah, well, we're 80 years old and still banging the rafters, you know, it's still an uncomfortable situation, but they can take it. And that's the way countries are. People are children, and they scream, I want to know, I want to know, but really, they can't handle it. It's not something that the general public needs to know. And I, for one, don't want them to know. You know, it's for my safety, your safety, my children's safety, that this stuff isn't out. Do you know what I'm saying?
I do. Certain things are better left unsaid.
Right, that's, exactly. You know, and we do. We shape factors, people. We're old. Okay, we have a couple of questions here. And since the last one is showing, I'm going to tackle that one. Let's see, questions from England. A poll released shows 80% of Americans think the government is hiding knowledge of the existence of terrestrial life forms, while 37% say they have contacted the U.S. government. So if aliens did just land on the White House grass, then would it really cause a panic, in your opinion?
Absolutely. Just a case in point, just to answer, and thank the individual for that question. Just as an example, let's remember the Orson Welles incident up in your area, New Jersey, back in early 1900s. Mm-hmm. You know how many people jumped out of the windows in New York City, and how many people killed themselves, and what kind of chaos? Just that local, and of course radio was
the
still
war
in its infancy.
Of the worlds.
The War of the Worlds, yeah.
My mother-in-law was screaming her head off because she missed the beginning. And
my grandfather told me that their neighbors were jumping out the windows.
She was screaming. She was screaming, and my father-in-law was saying, Ida, there's nobody. We live in New Jersey. If they were bombing New York, we'd hear it. It's only 30 miles away, for God's sake.
Yeah.
And she was hysterical. People were going to kill their children that night.
That's right. That's right. And my grandfather, I can remember my grandfather telling us the story of he and my grandmother watching people jump out windows. And people were screaming and there were riots in the streets and it was just terrible. So to answer that person's question, hey, I just don't think the general public could handle something like that.
Yeah.
There would be absolute chaos.
Yeah, he's saying, but that was back then, and this is back now. But you have to remember something, Spooky. You think that back then we didn't consider life on other planets. I was raised on Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon. It was assumed there was life on other planets. We weren't raised not to think that that was happening. But the idea of someone with that kind of technology coming here when we were going to be defenseless, and let's face it, I don't care where they're from. If they come here, they've got more technology than us. And we are outgunned, outmanned, and everything else. They can do anything they want to us, and that would scare a lot of people.
That would scare a lot of people.
I do not think we have advanced enough that, considering what we know and what could happen, people would be able to handle it. I absolutely don't.
I agree with you. We're probably 200 or 300 years away from achieving a class one culture.
Mm-hmm.
We're at least that far away. But just to digress for a second and just carry on a thought.
Okay.
The prospect of extraterrestrials, you know, extraterrestrial existence is not something that is taken lightly by many, many scientists. Frank Drake, for example, who developed the Drake equation. Drake estimates that there are probably anywhere from 3 to 4 billion cultures, and it just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger, just based on that equation, and and it's a probability equation of the existence of other life forms in the universe. The universe is so large that the probability of there being of our being the only form of sentient existence in this whole place, well, to paraphrase Brother Einstein, you know, it would be such a terrible waste of space, you know, to only have one sentient being in something so large. So we must then assume that the probability exists that there are probably more sentient beings out there somewhere. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we're not in regular communication with them, or maybe we are, is elementary. Mm-hmm. You know, I am aware of a group in Stockholm that has identified and has centered into a constant signal. I'm in communication with them. And I know for a fact that their research has been absolutely crushed by world governments. Not only the United States, but other governments, their own governments, and in collusion and cooperation, and they have found the signal. And the folks down there at SETI, they refuse to acknowledge it. They won't even put they won't put Arecibo anywhere near it. They won't even put it in the direction.
Right.
Because they don't want to find it. But it's there. And the information is published, and the people who are doing the work are friends of mine, and I know their work, and they are real scientists. Unfortunately, their funding has been pulled. No, it's no big surprise. So their funding has been pulled, but you can't destroy the radio records. You know, once it's a radiogram stays a radiogram forever until somebody destroys it. And they've got the radiograms with the exact coordinates of this signal. And it's a sentient signal, and it's in mathematical code. So something is sending a signal from someplace in space. It's not that far away either. It's only about 7 light years away. So it's in the neighborhood, you know, astrologically speaking. Yeah, astrophysically speaking.
Hang on a minute. Yeah. We got a question here. What is the question?
Say another galaxy was inhabited. They're so far away. Wouldn't they just be receiving our first radio signals that we sent back in, you know, when radio was invented in the 1800s? I mean, a distance. The radio waves had to travel.
Did you get that?
Yeah, I got it. Yeah, well, what's the question? Are they just hearing the radio waves now?
Yeah, wouldn't they just be getting radio waves that we sent because of the time distance?
Well, yes, if, you know, that's the case, provided the person on the other hand, on the other side, has not engendered and already enabled time bending and time warps and time shifts and multidimensionality that I've mentioned earlier. You know, our perception of sending a radio signal, and probably the person who posed the question, is that signal is going to go, and it propagates as a conventional signal would on an oscilloscope. They're thinking in terms of okay, they see a flat wave, a frequency modulation, an amplitude modulation, they see a straight line, or they might see a series of waves going out and broadcasting, much the way you would see the waves in the pond when you drop a stone in and you have that wave propagation. Well, that works good if everything is linear, but read Mitchell Kaku's latest work. Everything's not linear. Everything, according to the conventional theorists and Stephen Hawking included, purport that the universe is moving toward sphericity. Everything is moving into a sphere. Now, if that is indeed the case, and there's any credence at all to this notion of sphericity and the way that chaos joins all of these things, and if we consider Einstein rings and time bending and time warps, then it's possible then that this signal that we think is propagating in a straight line, in fact, is going somewhere where time is being bent, where the conventional time warp schema that we have in our minds, it doesn't exist. It's really, the time is being bent, and the signals are literally being grasped within seconds, as opposed to light years. So the whole concept of light years, although it's demonstrated in the E equals MC2 and propagated thereby, it doesn't always obtain because of the notion of these prospects of time warping and time bending and multi-dimensionality and time rifts. There are time rifts and there's a tear in space. Have you read about the tear in space? Mm-hmm. And no one knows what this tear is. There's this big hole that Hubble has found, and the scientists out at Berkeley and some of the other places, they're calling it a time shear. It's a rip in the space in time warp, which it's probably not outside the realm of possibility. These things, sound doesn't always move in a straight line. Time doesn't move in a straight line. It's been demonstrated that, there's a guy that he's on Facebook, and I don't want to mention his name because we sort of had a falling out.
Don't worry. It's regretful that we did.
But there is such a thing as time travel, not in the conventional sense that you would think of Rod Serling sitting in the time machine and switching a bunch of dials, and then he's going back to the locons and all that stuff. No, it doesn't work that way. But time does bend, and there are things, and you can actually observe this if, the people listening, go and look up Einstein rings and do the physics and look at the physics behind that. And the Amici Bertrand. Go see who Amici was. Well, who was Amici? Well, Amici taught Galileo. So, there's a whole history of brilliant men who discovered things, and the next guy would come along, the next guy would come along. But where this all goes is, to get back to the question, time and space are not linear. They can be curved. This is well documented in the evidence in the literature. There's a whole body of evidence to support that. And it only follows that electrical signals, which are part of that time in a certain frequency range, they can be bent as well. And they can go through a time warp and shift phase. And it's all about shifting phase. You want a good example? Let me give you a good example of how to shift phase.
Okay, just a minute. We have questions that are in the thing, so you're going to have to end it so I can ask these questions for these people.
Wait a second. Well, okay, you only get me for a certain while. When I'm on a roll and giving a dissertation, it's a good thing to listen. But just, this is benefit to your people.
Okay.
Because a lot of them, this is going to explain a question that most of your people have had in their minds for all of their lives. Here's an example of the shift in the phase of time and how time travel, just even for the instant, is possible. I want your people to look directly ahead, wherever they are, stop what you're doing. You're safe, of course. You're at home or whatever. You're not driving a car. Look directly ahead just for a second. Now, shake your head as fast as you can, but try to focus on what you were originally looking at. Now, what you're experiencing there, as your head and your eyes turn and you lose focus, what you are experiencing is the shift in the phase of time. Now, something is happening between that millisecond where you lose focus, and guess what? That's quantifiable, and there are people who can jump in between that, whether you believe it or not. So that's all I'm going to say about that. As,
I just say when that happens, I just say it's the lupus and the MS kicking up.
Well, okay.
I'm sorry, I just fell over.
Touche. Touche. I like that. That's good, Mo. I'm going to remember that one. That's a good one. But
people, don't worry. It's a normal thing for me to fall over like this.
Yeah. Well, that gives everybody an idea of what the significance of the shift in the phase of time. So if that happens to you in your phase and in your reality, just think what somebody with a black budget can do. So, you take it from there.
Yeah.
Hey, this is fun. Let's get these questions. Come on, I'm on a roll.
We have a lot of them, and some of them I know is technology regarding the BP oil spill and the damage being done by spray vortex by Woogie.
You know, on the BP oil spill, you know, I've had a hand in the cleanup of that, and I was responsible for developing the technology and the microencapsulation technologies used to clean up the Valdez spill. So my history there goes back, and my PhD is in bioremediation, biodefense, oil spill cleanup, that kind of stuff. But, you know, this planet is really, really wonderful. In the grand scheme of things, if no matter how big that oil spill is, we leave it alone, and nature's going to clean it up. There are these little microorganisms there that eventually will clean it up. And it's just the way it happens. You know, if you look at the Pleistocene era, you know, and the La Brea tar pits and those sorts of things back during the Ice Age and the Stone Age and the Megalithic Age, you had oil spills back then. We didn't know it was oil because, you know, Cro-Magnon man and you know, Neanderthalans and that sort of thing. But, you know, that didn't ruin the earth. And when you had volcanism and volcanoes and oil came out and natural gas vents all the time, the earth has its own way of cleaning up, and part of that is related to the Krebs cycle and the way that the atmosphere is cleaned. So, you know, I don't see where, you know, the big oil spills, that's not going to cause the demise of man. And, you know, now that you've opened Pandora's box, let's talk about global warming, huh? Yeah, don't even go there. Global warming, what a bunch of crap. Hey, my guys, my colleague at NOAA, they saw that stuff come out and said, "Joe, this is all bunk, man. This is and it's bunk." And write a book and get a Nobel Prize. I'm like, "Oh, you got to be kidding me, man. You got to be, you know, I can't even spell the word." But anyhow,
you know, is it impossible for them to understand our planet goes through these cycles? Where, you know, different
absolutely.
Parts become covered with ice, well, other parts don't become covered with ice. I mean, it's been going on since the Big Bang, right?
Yeah, for millennia. Dr. John Clarkson out at University of Washington, he has written a treatise on this where he's proven, as has Dr. Richard Archer. They have proven categorically that the Earth is cyclic, and it goes through these cycles. And that's how we're able to predict, you know, an oncoming ice age in another 40,000 years. It's a cycle. It's just like everything else on this planet. It goes through a cycle, just like the Krebs cycle, the way that the atmosphere cleans itself, the way that, you know, children are born, and, you know, the birth-death cycle, that sort of thing. It's all a cycle. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a circle of life, so to speak. The Earth has its own circle, too.
It's not the first time we've had this kind of global warming, you know.
No, we haven't. You know. No one back in the late 1800s, we had Krakatoa. Krakatoa let go, and it's you're familiar with that. You see what happened. That resulted in, you know, 7 years of drought and storms, and well, it eventually cleared, and that's just the way the Earth will take care of itself through the processing of the Krebs cycle. It'll do all those things, and the primary producers are going to clean that stuff up. And there are organisms that eat oil, eat crude oil. I mean, if you pick up seawater or salt water or go out in your gutter, you have nematodes, tardigrades, rotifers, all types of these microorganisms that literally eat that type of stuff. And there's bacteria that grow on it and thrive on it and evolve on it. So I don't see it as, it's really, you know, at the risk of sounding blasé, it's really not that big a deal because the ocean will take care of itself and there's enough tidal flushing there in that Gulf of Mexico that eventually it'll all be flushed out.
It'll go
into the seas and it'll be taken care
right.
of, remediated.
I think the problem with that whole mess down there is that stupidity caused it. And people like me, I think, you know, the freaking, excuse me, the manatees manatees don't have enough to deal with, you know,
yeah.
that they got this garbage going on, you know, that annoys me. But I think we've become a society that expects fixes right away. You know, we expect to be able to control things. It's kind of like watching a Star Trek show or something,
yeah.
or one of those old Ron Sterling, The Twilight Zone, where everybody, once they hit 13, they go and get the artificial face made because they want to look like Model A,
yeah,
B, C, D.
Yeah, I remember that
remember
one, yeah.
that one?
Yeah, I sure do. The guy with the big ears and stuff. Yeah.
But I think that's what we have become to it. And it's made us, you know, people look at older generations and say, well, they weren't progressive. But you know what? I'm seeing a lot of people that are unable to accept snowballs in the face anymore.
Yeah.
And that's what I call this kind of stuff. Snowballs in the face. Bad things happen. Get over it and get your rear end in gear.
Yeah.
We're being asked in the chat, how bad is Corexit?
Corexit's pretty... Okay, is that a question for me?
Yes.
Corexit is pretty bad. It's pretty bad. It actually is a toxin, but believe it or not, it was the first one... actually, it was the second... product listed on the NCP product schedule in 1989. I know my product, WAPED, was the first product listed on the NCP product schedule under 40 CFR subpart J. I know I helped to write the law. I helped to write the doctrine with Scientech, Julie Jordan out of Scientech. Apparently, I was one of the only guys that ever read the law, and I found a hole in the law and called her and said, Julie, you're missing subpart J. Well, Joe, I said, is anybody reading this stuff? She said, well, apparently not. What needs to go in there? I said, well, you need to put my invention in there. So they did, and that's how, well, shortly after that, Corexit came in and was listed on the NCP product schedule and consequently used up in Valdez. So, but Corexit's it kills. It's a toxin. It kills and it breaks up. It bonds with the oil, then eventually breaks it down, and you know you've got these big plumes out there, and you're going to have it for a while until it eventually breaks down too. And it's designed to be a surfactant to keep the oil from congealing all in one place, but it works moderately, but it's dangerous stuff.
My doctor, so. Because I have everything in the world wrong with me, and I've chosen not to go on a lot of different medications.
Yeah.
Because his famous words are, nothing is free. Everything has an impact. And if you don't believe me, you watch any of these commercials for Viagra, for all this garbage. If your teenage daughter starts growing facial hair, you know, that means she somehow came in contact with this medicine. And quick, call your doctor. Everything has an impact. There's a price to pay for everything. So if we do something wrong and we use something thinking we're going to clean it up real quick with something else, we've exchanged one hell for another, right?
I agree.
Yeah. We only have 10 minutes to go. And this is my question, because when we originally talked a few weeks ago, you said, hey, Mo, I'm going to take on Bigfoot and see what I can find out about it. So what have you found out about it since you've been doing this?
Well, I went to some people, some old friends of mine that I've known for many, many years, and the general consensus is that this is a real animal that is yet to be ascribed a scientific nomenclature. that the existence is undeniable, that it's real, and it's protected in many areas of the country. In many areas of the country, there's actual legislation, and there are laws that prevent you from hunting a Bigfoot.
Mm-hmm.
So, my personal belief is that it's an unknown species, that it's real, and it exists. There's just too much evidence to deny it. There's the, of course, the anecdotal evidence in terms of the stories. There's the archaeological evidence in terms of the footprints. Excuse me. There is some hair evidence that has not been able to be identified for one reason or another. But in my opinion, Bigfoot's real. It's real.
There's something
now, whether or not, yeah, whether or not it came from another planet, as John Lear has promulgated and postulated, I don't know. He may have information that I don't have. But the people that I've spoken with on the, in quote unquote, on the inside, and you didn't hear me say that, they say it's real. They say,
okay.
Now, they don't have any in their possession.
Yeah.
The people I work with, they don't have a carcass or anything like that. But their orders are to leave it alone. The guys who routine and do things like bivouac and exercises, and now I'm not going to mention
right.
who or what that is, but that orders are to leave it alone. Do not the standing order is do not engage.
That's what I would like to see done. Personally, I wish everybody would just stop looking for it and leave it alone. But then I feel the same way about ghosts. You know, so leave them alone. You know, they lived, they're died, that's it. Vans for Vets. Would you please explain what all that is and where people can get a hold of that?
Oh, that's nice of you. Yeah.
I was reminded by somebody, so don't give me too much credit.
Okay. Yeah, well, Vans for Vets is an organization. It's a 501c3 that I set up a few years ago after I was injured myself. And the vets, a lot of my friend vets helped me get through a pretty bad ordeal. Well, I promised myself that, you know, if I lived through all that stuff, that I was going to do something to give back, not only to America, but to the vets and all the guys coming back from the war. You know, there's a real problem with, and it's a recalcitrant problem ever since the war started, you know, the Gulf War started. Kids coming back from the war are having problems getting medical attention and getting to the VA and getting rides, and a lot of them are coming back as multiple amputees, SCR, spinal cord injury patients, and they're not allowed to take their families with them when they're transported in government vans, etc. So oftentimes what happens, because they can't get medical treatment when they need it, they'll self-medicate in the form of illicit drugs, illegal drugs, or alcohol. And when that happens, disaster strikes that family. And the children suffer, the family suffers. In many cases, suicide results. So, my friends and I, Colonel Moss, Colonel Tim O'Neill, Sergeant Rick Cups, you guys I've known for 30 years, I mean, these are absolutely outstanding individuals. Well, I got together with the guys and said, hey, I've got this idea. I want to stand up this agency, this 501c3. I'm going to put a bunch of dough into it, and we're going to buy handicapped equipped vehicles, used vehicles. We're going to buy them from places, from the government, and from like places like govdeals.com and surplus.com, and we're going to provide them to our people coming back from the war free of charge. And we're going to give them other services too, like education, referrals, drug and alcohol. We're going to try to get you a job. Heck, we've got some clients, we bought them handicapped equipped vehicles. Not only do they use them for self-transportation, but we got them licenses where they now own their own transportation business. So we've been able to do things like that where we've taken, where, you know, folks have come to us, they don't have a job, they don't have a home, they don't have a vehicle, so we get them a vehicle, one that they can transport other people in, then we go to the Department of Transportation, get them a local license, then the next thing you know, guess what? They're making $5,000 a week transporting people, and they're back in society, they're off of the public assistance rolls, and they're back with their families.
Mm-hmm.
They've got their kids and their lives back. And they're not drinking, and they're not killing themselves, and you're going to church, and they've got their self-reliance back, and they feel like it, and it's just good all around. So that's what Vans for Vets is all about.
Yeah, and we have a Iraqi vet in the family. And
yeah.
I am up the VA in East Orange, and I'm down in Brick constantly.
Yeah.
A lot of these kids, their families are drained from trying to get them back and forth. And
absolutely.
And you're talking about a lot of these kids, maybe they're the youngest, and their parents are older. I mean, Teddy and
sure.
I aren't kids, you know?
Sure.
And so these kids are coming back with severe brain injuries, missing limbs, and everything under the sun. And it's so hard because we are a society that if it's not in our face, please hide it. You know, we don't want
right.
to see what's coming back. You know,
that's
just
right.
keep it in the corner someplace and just
yeah.
keep it away from me. And,
yeah,
and
put
we
it
can't
up in the attic,
that.
Yeah.
Right, yeah, we can't have
yeah.
that. We can't allow that to happen. So
yeah.
your site, I just brought it up, and it's Vans, V-A-N-S, for F-O-R, Vets, V-E-T-S.org.
That's right. That's right. We're a 501c3. In fact, we just opened... 3 weeks ago, we opened a new chapter in San Diego. Johnny Thompson and his wife April and the kids are doing a bang up job. We've got another place up in Hudson, Michigan. Hello to Mark Randolph. Mark, if you're listening, my sister Polly Callen, who called in a few minutes ago, she runs the chapter in Virginia Beach, Virginia. We've got Davey Callen, who runs the place down in Duquesne Marina, North Carolina. I just opened a new chapter here in Hickory, North Carolina last week. So we're going to be doing some things here. And we've got Denver, we've got Texas, we've got Michigan, we've got Maine. We're all over the place, and we help. Actually, Mo, we've got over 5,600 requests for vehicles that we cannot fill. So if somebody has a vehicle out there that they want to donate, and we're not like, you know, other agencies or... like these other agencies for the blind that'll take in cars and then they sell the car and
right.
keep the money and pay salaries. Everyone in our organization, we have 12 administrators in our organization. Our overhead is $12 a year. Everybody that works for Vans for Vets is on a volunteer basis. The ones that sit on the board of directors, they by law are required to be under contract, and for that they're paid the fee of $1 per year. Everyone else is strictly volunteer. There are no perquisites. We have no overhead. I pay for everything, and the directors, we pay for all to support the each of the individual chapters is self-supporting, and whoever takes on that responsibility supports the chapter. Of course, under the onus of the 501c3, they can do things like take donations and stuff. What we
right.
need are cars. Give us the cars. We don't care what kind of shape they're in. We'll fix them up. And we'll, you know, we have people who need a car just to go back and forth to work. And, you know, they've been in and out of rehab. They can't find a job. They just,
right.
and their they have no families.
Or the families,
you know,
are just to the point now where
unable to help them. You know,
they
things
can't
are bad.
Help them anymore. Yeah, they can't
really,
help
things
anymore.
Are bad. So that's what we're doing. And we do it
okay.
on a case-by-case basis at the grassroots level. And, you know, we do other things too, like pay people's electric bills, and we're not going to let anybody go hungry. We're not going
to
let the kids go without clothing and stuff like that. So
I have to cut you off. We got to close up the show. I want to thank you so much for coming on. Next week we're going to have Matthew Reed from the Reed abductions case that MUFON is taking care of. And with that, I'm going to close real fast. God bless you all. God bless America. Thank you, Joe. I love you so much.
Thank you, Mo.
For being on.
Mo, God bless you and your family. God bless America. God
bless
everyone.
America.
Over and out. Over and out from the Green Mountain Lab.
Where over the rainbow birds fly.
Thank you for visiting me at my lair. Moebanshee. energy flares broadcast live on Tuesday evenings at 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Mountain, 7 p.m. Pacific, and in the UK, 3 a.m. Wednesday mornings on www.gameconradio.com. You can listen to our recent recordings on Podomatic/Moebanshee. You can contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for listening. God bless you and yours, and have a very cool day. I'm